And he looks at me and he says, young man, you got my business. And I think he looked at me and he could tell, like, it kind of surprised me. He says, you want to know why I'm giving you this account? And I said, yeah, I'd love to hear this. He says, the jingle's okay and your ideas are fine. He says, but I want your enthusiasm. I want your excitement. You are so enthusiastic about my business and what I'm trying to do. I want that here at this dealership. In other words, he bought the excitement in my voice about his business and what he was trying to do. And that was a real valuable early lesson for me, that if you can't show that you're excited about something, if you can't show someone that you're excited about your idea, so many people try to be so cool and smooth that they fail to communicate that what the idea that they've got or their excitement behind their idea, that people buy positivity. People buy that excitement. They buy that energy.
Hello, Profit First entrepreneurs and thought leaders. I am so excited today because in anticipation of our book that's going to be released, Profit First for Minority Business Enterprises, I get the opportunity to interview Kim Yancey, who's also going to be featured on our book. And Kim is the co-founder and president of eWomen Network, and he's also the executive producer of Celebrity Science Branding at the E! Network. Prior to starting eWomen Network, he was awarded a gold record as a drummer, producer, songwriter, and performer with the fun group Sun on Capitol Records. So he's a musician. He's also the creator and producer of The Glow Project. And The Glow Project was heralded as one of the most inspiring movies ever created for women by the Orlando Film Festival. And as the executive producer and founder of Celebrity Science, which is a division of the eWomen Network, he creates influential personal brands. He is recognized by CNN as an American hero for his work that he has done with the outreach program associated with Hurricane Katrina victims. So please welcome Kim Yancey to our platform. Hi, Kim. How are you?
Hey, Suzanne. It's great to have this time with you. Doing great, considering a pandemic, you know, that we're living through. No, just doing great.
Well, Kim, you are a legend, right? You are a legend with E! Network and your music. And I think that you offer not only our readers, but our viewers and listeners a lot of value with just the experiences that you have gone through with that. And as a minority entrepreneur, as one that works with countless minority entrepreneurs, I think that what you've experienced and what you have to give our audience is very significant and very important. So thank you for doing that today.
It's a pleasure. It really is. I think it's very important that we share, because, you know, that's, we all learn from, you know, other people and their experiences. And so, listen, I want to do whatever I can to contribute in some way anyway.
Thank you. I definitely appreciate it. So, Kim, maybe we can start with you telling us a little bit about your business. How did you journey into it? How did you find it? What made you even want to start it?
Well, you know, I have an advertising agency background. So prior to launching eWomen Network with my wife, Sandra, 20 years ago, as a matter of fact, September 18th is our 20th anniversary. And I had an advertising agency for 15 years. And that it was actually an offshoot from the band, from being with the group Sun on Capitol Records. And I'd be remiss to say, if you ever want to check us out, just go to YouTube and do a search for Sun on Soul Train. I'm the drummer, the guy in the back with the big hair, okay? But it was the running an advertising agency, did that for 15 years. And from that, I really focused on multicultural marketing then. I was really into, you know, what I call niche marketing and advertising. And, you know, from that led into the start of eWomen Network, which was really, we had moved from Ohio where we lived to one of my accounts that launched a positive TV television network in Dallas. And I loved it. And I was doing some work and helping them with their advertising. And while I was here on some business, the founder of that network asked me, you know, what would it take to get you to move to Dallas and to take over all the marketing and everything for this full time to be part of our team? And I had 40 employees. And that's one of the first lessons I got right then and there, in that you can own a business and be completely burnt out with it. I mean, it's, you know, it's very common for someone to have a business and you're working it and grinding away at it and you're growing. And still, you know, I know for me, my original purpose in having that advertising agency back then was really to create a revenue stream for myself that I could spend more time working on my other music projects. Well, you know, the laugh or the gag in that whole thing is the fact that business takes up a lot of time. And if you're growing, you know, it craves every ounce of creativity and every idea and insight that you have. And of course, you know, supporting the your team members that are on your team and all of that. And so when he asked me, you know, about that, I couldn't believe it because I was having private conversations with myself about, you know, wanting to go on a different path, you know, take a different route. And so I ended up selling my advertising agency to my employees and moved to Dallas to take over the marketing for this Positive TV network. And through that experience, my wife, while we were in Dallas, I said to her one day, I said, you know, Sandra, there are major corporations here that are looking for you and they don't know you're here. And there are people within those major corporations that you need to meet and you don't know how to reach them and you don't know their name. And I thought, you know, you've got your master's degree, you're smart, you know, you're doing incredible work. If you're going through this, I can only imagine how many other countless millions of women are going through the exact same thing. And that really led to the start of launching eWomen Network to help specifically to help women, even though there are men who are part of it, to help women get connected and to market and promote their businesses.
Oh, wow. And that's even more important now too, now that we live in the virtual world, right? We can no longer like go and physically meet people. It's really a global economy now. So
Totally.
You're very busy right now. That is amazing. And I think that you bring up a good point too about scaling, right? You said 40 employees in your advertising agency and, you know, being profit first and being a profit first channel and profit first book, you know, a lot of entrepreneurs don't realize that, you know, they you hear a lot of people talking about the top line, the revenue, right, and proud of the number of employees. So there's a complexity too with being able to scale profitably and scale in a way that really allows you to keep your margins and your percentage of profitability too with that.
That's right. That's right. Totally. Yeah, I agree.
And then, I mean, of course, being responsible for 40 family lives too.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, Kim, as an entrepreneur, what have you found to be the biggest, what was your biggest hurdle in entrepreneurship?
Well, no doubt it was consistent cash flow. I mean, you know, every entrepreneur is going to come face to face when they start a business or they decide to go out on their own is, you know, how do you bring in new business while you're doing the business you're working on? So if you're my client, Suzanne, and I'm helping you and working, helping you with marketing strategies and branding and all those kinds of things, well, I'm spending time with you. What I'm not doing is I'm not out networking and meeting other people because I'm so tied up with the person I'm doing business with. And so that's the real catch 22 is that point where you realize, you know what, I'm going to pay myself less and make sure I'm getting out here and filling my pipeline and meeting people and growing my business and getting referrals. Because there is this point where the time you're spending with the client and you're enjoying yourself, you have to be thinking about that next infusion of business that's going to come into you. And so I had to figure that out. So for me, that was a big thing. And I started pretty early with retainers. You know, I cut my teeth when I started my advertising agency on car dealerships. You know, I would see car dealers advertise, and I'll never forget, there was one in Dayton, Ohio, is my home, which happens to be a little trivia for everybody. The funk capital of the world is Dayton, Ohio. incredible groups from there. Ohio Players, Slave, Heat Wave, Sun, Roger, and Zap. So anyway, give you a little history about Dayton, Ohio. But I remember being in Dayton and I saw a car dealer advertising. And it was the standard, you know, stand up in front of the car and tell everybody I got the best prices, I got the best service, you know, I got the best inventory. You know, it was the same old stuff. And I remember calling him, and his name was DeWitt Pefley was his name. The dealership was called Pefley Ford. And I remember calling him on the phone and telling him that, you know, I'm from Dayton and I've seen his advertising, and that in essence that he needed a fresher approach. He needed something that was going to stand out because he's saying the same thing all the time. And he said to me, he said, you know, do you have any idea how many people call me to tell me they've got a better idea? And he says, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you 5 minutes on this date that was 3 months out into the future, Suzanne. And I'm going to give you 5 minutes for you to show me what you've got. And I'll never forget that. I remember telling my wife, I said, you know, I should probably cancel. As it got closer and closer, I thought to myself, I probably should cancel this. And I said, this was a guy that was in his, at that time, he looked to me like he was in his upper 60s. He looked like one of these, you know, what I would classify back then, because I was in my 20s, you know, a good old boy, and he seemed pretty gruff to me. And I thought, I'm going to walk in here with this big afro and this youth, you know, and I'm thinking he's going to like prejudge me. And I was playing all these tricks, mind games on myself about the reasons why maybe I should cancel. I don't think it's going to be a good fit. And I think it's one of the things that entrepreneurs do too, is that, you know, they can talk themselves out of something. Well, here was the aha moment for me. And I'm going to pass this on to everybody. I walked into that dealership and he was sitting behind his desk and he had three or four of his other salespeople there, all in polyester suits. And they were all standing with their arms crossed. And he says, what do you got? And I had some music I created. I created a demo of a jingle I had gotten with some musician friends who I told them what I was going to do. I said, I'm going to put together a little jingle for him and some copy. They all did it for me for free. I said, because if I sell this thing, I'm going to give you a share of the profits, you know, but I need to have something to walk in there with. And they were all on board and willing to do this with me. And I played him a jingle and had some other ideas. And he looks at me and he says, young man, you got my business. And I think he looked at me and he could tell, like, it kind of surprised me. He says, you want to know why I'm giving you this account? And I said, yeah, I'd love to hear this. He says, the jingle's okay and your ideas are fine. He says, but I want your enthusiasm. I want your excitement. You are so enthusiastic about my business and what I'm trying to do. I want that here at this dealership. In other words, he bought the excitement in my voice about his business and what he was trying to do. And that was a real valuable early lesson for me, that if you can't show that you're excited about something, if you can't show someone that you're excited about your idea, so many people try to be so cool and smooth that they fail to communicate that what the idea that they've got or their excitement behind their idea, that people buy positivity. People buy that excitement. They buy that energy. And that was, you know, that's nothing that's particularly taught in any school or any program. You know, that's a part of life. It's part of, you know, that it factor, that charisma that you bring to something. But that really taught me something. He wanted my excitement and desire to bring something new to his dealership. That's what he wanted, over and above the ideas that I had given him.
That is an amazing story. That is an amazing story with a lot of like really big golden nuggets in there, Kim. You know, not just about, you know, the initial just advice on scaling and cash flow, but really the advice that you just gave us about walking into the room. Walking into the room when you don't have a chance in the world in your mind to get that opportunity, right? Walking in a room where, you know, like you talked, you know, the guy was in his 60s, what could be perceived as a good old boys club. And you went in that room as a minority, as a young man, and you got that and you presented your best. You had enthusiasm. And because I know a lot of us as minority men and women, you know, there's that imposter syndrome, right? A lot of times in our careers, as we're escalating and we're going beyond our family legacies and going beyond where we've ever come before, one of the issues that we have is that sense of, do we belong here, when the only people that are in the room in the banquet hall are the janitors and the wait staff, right?
Yeah, that is the biggest thing. I mean, I never liked going to networking events. I always felt like I lost. I always felt that I'd go to a networking event and I went there wanting, if I was talking to you, Suzanne, I'm like letting you talk and I'm thinking in my mind, well, you know, are you about finished so I can tell you about me? You know, I didn't understand the principles. No one had shared with me what networking was all about. And so the whole concept, there was a friend of mine, brilliant. His name is George Fraser. And he's out of Cleveland, and he is a best-selling author. He's incredible. And I'll never forget that during my ad agency days, I went to a book signing that in Dayton, Ohio. He was there. And I never went out networking. I just never did. I always felt awkward. And I really do now I understand that a whole lot of that awkwardness was what was in my own head, was what I had conjured up in my own thinking of what people thought of me or whatever the case may be. But I went to George's book signing, and he had a book out called Success Runs in Our Race, and powerful. I had heard about him, but I had never met him. It was in the middle of the afternoon. I go to the book signing. There were probably 10, 12 people in the store milling around. They had some chairs. And I stood up the entire time to watch George. And George said to me, he says, first of all, he says, let me explain to you what networking is. He says, networking is about giving. It isn't about getting. You network to give, not to get. Just that changed everything for me when it came to networking. He says, when you network to give, you always feel energized. You always feel happy to be involved in meeting people because you're looking for ways to give to them. You're taking the pressure off you to get something. And that reciprocity, people, the universal law, so to speak, of reciprocity, of, you know, when you give to others, people want to do the same thing to, for you. Now, you don't give thinking, I'm giving to you, so I expect something back. You give authentically to, because you want to help. And through that, it just naturally happens for you. And that changed, you know, everything for me. But that whole thing of the games we play on ourselves, of what we think and how we think people are perceiving us and understanding us, we can think our way out of an opportunity. And Pefley Ford situation and that meeting, that networking meeting chance with George Frazier just changed the trajectory of my life.
Oh yeah, definitely. And that's a good way to think about it too. I mean, you get out of your head by putting someone else first. How right. can I serve this person? Not focusing on why I'm different or they're different from me, but focusing on how can I make their life better? How can I solve their problem? Right. And doing it with a passion, doing what you do out of your own eagerness and enthusiasm. I love that. Thank you, Kim. Yeah. I think that is a juicy morsel there and great advice there with that, because, you know, especially as we create and go into new realms, right, we're going to have to get out of our head. So, and enter new rooms and enter right. new opportunities and really begin to operate on a global phase. So thank right. you. That I think that is really good. Now I'm curious, like in terms of like, you obviously work with a lot of women-owned businesses. You work with a lot of minority-owned businesses. What do you think is today the top barrier to them being able to succeed and scale and really become the seven-figure, eight-figure businesses?
Well, yeah, I think there are several things. I think it is, first of all, I think your mindset is really, really important. I think being willing, I do believe that networking is a major key in this, in learning, always being a student, always... You know, that whole concept of day one, of almost every day is like day one, you're learning. I mean, I'm going through a phase right now where I feel like I'm in first grade. I'm learning some whole things about internet marketing and that kind of thing that I was not familiar with. So I feel like I'm a first grader right now. And that stuff gets to be, you know, just scary. But I think, you know, you have to understand that there are so many forces. And I don't mean people are conspiring to go against you, but, you know, from TV ads, I mean, especially as a woman, I mean, clearly all the TV ads communicate a message that, you know, the color lipstick you're wearing is not the right color. There's a better blush. There's a creamier, better hair product for you. I mean, women are constantly being bombarded with products and services that clearly say, if you're going to be in the wow club, you know, you've got to have these things. So you have that coming at you at all times. And I think, you know, especially with women, they're so used to seeing, I mean, it's shifted greatly from the time, you know, I had the agency and where eWomen Network is 20 years later, but especially in the very beginning, there is what I call the male way of networking. And from the very beginning, we really started to focus on the unique ways in which women build rapport and connect and communicate with each other. And men don't understand a lot of that. I mean, you know, just taking a position where like slow it all down, you know, back down your testosterone in terms of being this guy and just listen and take in and be more gracious. So, but I will tell you this, in terms of what I see, I think that it's really important that people clearly learn how to articulate how what they have to offer is going to help someone else solve their problem. I mean, it really is the old, what I call problem solution. And I think that a lot of people that I meet, when you meet them, what I call that elevator pitch, whether you're meeting them at a networking event or on the elevator or you're meeting people, you know, people don't introduce themselves in a way that people understand very often what they do. I mean, you know, there's a real technique to how do you introduce yourself? The kind of clarity that you create for people. I mean, it's not uncommon at all for me to meet someone and they tell me they do X, Y, and Z. And I'm like, oh, that's great. But I really had no idea really how that would help me or what the benefit to me. So what that means is you've got to learn how to take what you do and to package it in such a way that the other person understands that this is something that could be workable and really good for me. I also think that people need to look at, some people, you know, it's really kind of popular now for people to talk about, you know, there's no competition in the marketplace. I don't know who started that, but I disagree. I disagree. There are a lot of people that will, in most cases, offer what you offer. And I learned a very insightful lesson there, too, when I was on Capitol Records. I remember when we got our gold album at Capitol Records, and the whole band was up there, and the president of Capitol Records was taking pictures with us, and he said to me specifically, and he says, Kim, he says, something I want you to never forget. He says, every year there are 1,000 new I Love You songs that hit the market. He says, now they got a different beat, a little different melody, but somewhere in that song, somebody is saying, I love you. And he says, no matter how big the I Love You song of today is, the world wants a new Love You song, always. And it was like phenomenal, because the message here is, it doesn't matter if someone does what you do. The world wants new. We're always looking for new. We're always looking for a new spin on it, a new way to do it, a new energy, a new personality. I mean, it's the whole thing that, you know, if you're looking for a house, you got a real estate agent, and if the real estate agent doesn't excite you or doesn't seem enthusiastic for you, maybe you switch to someone else who's a real estate agent who is. My point of the matter is that no matter what your idea, no matter what your strategy is, don't be intimidated by someone else who might be singing your song. The world wants a new one. And you can sing the same song, but sing it differently and sing it better, sing it with a different beat. And really come out ahead. But that really helped me. And, you know, think about professional sports for a second. I mean, all of those athletes have coaches. And the coaches are course correcting them every moment of every practice, every day, right? And as entrepreneurs, we don't have anybody doing that for us. No one is course correcting you as you go, you know? So you've got to inquire. You've got to look at other things. It's important to look at, you know, your website. What does it look like? Someone's going to make a decision and have an opinion about you very quickly when they go to your website, or they look at your social media, or they see how you're communicating, you know, the tone that you have in the marketplace. I mean, it's such an incredibly different world we live in, because there are so many touch points, you know? And so I think it's easy to feel alone. It's easy to get overwhelmed and, you know, to constantly question yourself. And so that's why it's important to, I really do believe this, to get out, network. I even, you know, another tip that I can give you that will help you is when someone turns you down for a job. I had a client, this happened to be a pharmaceutical company. In fact, it was Pfizer. I'll just tell you, it was Pfizer. This was years ago. And they were launching a new product, and I gave them a proposal for them to, you know, for advertising. And the person turned me down. I'd give them the proposal, and they turned down the proposal, and they said, thanks, but no thanks. Now, that's an easy thing, and this is what most people do. Most people just say, daggone, I didn't get the job, and that's that. What I did is I called the person back. I didn't get them on the phone, but I got their voicemail. And I said to her, the woman's name was Kelly. And I said, hey, Kelly, this is Kim. Listen, I'm giving you a buzz, and I'm really calling you to ask you for, if you wouldn't mind, just give me a little help. You've already told me that my proposal, that you guys are passing on the proposal. But so I'm not calling about that. What I am calling about is if you would be so gracious as just to tell me what I did wrong. That's it. I just want to know, going into this, how I could have, what I should have done, what I should have considered when putting together this proposal, you know, to make this work. To make this work. So I'm just asking you to give me some feedback. It would help me in my personal development and my personal growth, and I'd be deeply appreciative. She called me back and she says, Kim, it was just over our budget by $15,000, whatever I was offering. She says, if it was just $15,000 less, if you could trim some things off, we'd go with that. And so I made a few little adjustments and sold it to them for $15,000 less and got the deal. The key was, is that I was very authentic when I was saying this to her. I just really wanted to know where I had gone wrong. Let me tell you another one, and people don't tell you this. There's another time I was going after a credit union to take care of their advertising, and I was going against several other agencies, and we put a lot of time into the plan, presented the plan, and the woman in charge of that came back and let me know that they decided not to go with me. They loved your plan, Kim, but they decided not to go with you. I said, why? She says, your plan was inside an Office Depot little three-ring stick-em thing, like a, you know, where you where it's got three punch holes. You had it in there with a little sticker on the outside, and that was your plan. Your competitor had a suede binder, beautiful. Their logo was embossed and engraved inside the binder. They put it inside a box with tissue paper and closed it and gave it to us. I mean, they beat you before they even read your proposal, and your proposal was better. But they killed you in their presentation, in what they presented to the market. That was the last time that happened. That was like, wow. You know, I mean, the point of the matter is, you know, we get rejection, we get turned down. I mean, this stuff happens, and it's so important to understand why, what you're up against, why someone chose this person over you, as opposed to thinking, you know, it's something else.
Wow. I love that. It's courageous conversation, right? Being bold enough and having enough courage to ask, how could I have been better? How could I have met your needs so that I was selected? That is incredible with that. Cause you know, a lot of us, you know, we walk away and we have this head trash, right? When we don't get selected, right? Like, they didn't like me. I was the wrong color. I wasn't in the right friends club. And you're right. It's just having that key in your success was just having the courage to take that next step to say, what could I have done? And asking that person, what could I have done to have won your business? And I could probably tell you 99% of us out there would never do that.
Right.
Would never do that.
Oh yeah. You know, I mean, listen, I would have never thought when I got out of high school that we would have the racial strife that we go through in our world today. It was beyond my comprehension. I remember thinking, boy, one day in the future, we won't be going through this. How naive was I? And I say all this to say, I remember I was 16 and I was working in, they call it a five and dime. I don't know. It was just like a big, you know, like a CVS. It wasn't a CVS because this is when I was 16 years ago. And my manager was Black, great guy. Mr. Hunt was his name. Loved him. And he really liked me. And one day he says to me, he says, Kim, he says, what do you want to do with your life? And I said, well, you know what, Mr. Hunt, I want to get into acting. And Mr. Hunt looks at me, he says, you, an actor? Kim, actors are either black skin, white skin. You're a light-complected black man. They won't know what you are. It'll never work. You know, today I see all kind of light-complected people, all kind of mixed-race people. You know what I'm saying? I would have been right in Vogue. But the point of the matter is, you see how easy, like a judgment, a decision. He said that to me, and he said to me, he says, what are light-skinned black people do you see on TV? I thought, I can't think of anybody. You know, I couldn't think of anybody that looked like me. That's why it's so important with representation. You see people look like you, you know, all that. I mean, that's all part of it that makes it, which brings a lot of extra sensitivity to me because I really pay attention to that. You know, most people don't understand that most people of color, when they go into a room, if they're the only person of color in that room, guess what? They know it. I mean, they're aware. Ah, interesting. I'm the only person of color in this room. You know, and these are all scripts. These are all things that are part of our life experience and how we show up for things and how we experience things. And I also think that we are extraordinarily resilient too. You know what I mean? It's just once you get a hold of, you know, just those right group of mentors, and at eWomen Network, we also refer to them as femtors, as the wise and unique ways in which women mentor each other. We call them femtors.
I love that. That is really unique on that. I love that. So Kim, and I imagine this too. I mean, you know, you had enormous amount of courage to go into rooms where you felt that you probably weren't going to get selected, like the auto dealership, to have courage to even ask for feedback when you bid on a proposal and didn't quite get it. And obviously, yeah, interesting enough, you know, you were never rejected because of the color of your skin, which is wonderful that you have that. Tell me about, you know, a lot of us entrepreneurs out there and that are coming up, you know, a lot of us, you know, we grew up with the stories, right? We grew up with the stories of the neighborhood. We grew up with the stories that our parents told us, their parents told us, right? And how do you overcome those, the things that are in your head to step out of yourself, to go into the room when, like you said, nobody looks like you?
Well, you know, you gotta get comfortable with the uncomfortable. You have to put yourself in situations where you're not going to be comfortable. I mean, you're just not. Everything can't be, you know, just a comfort thing. And so I think, you know, for me, it is reading a lot. I mean, I went through a period where I was like a personal development junkie. And that meant every time I was in my car, I mean, I was listening to something that improved me, that helped me. For example, Dr. Nathaniel Brandon, he is an expert in the area of self-esteem. Self-esteem is huge, and you don't hear people talk about it very much, but, you know, he taught me something that I use, and that was that most people recycle other people's thinking. Now, think about that for a second, that as you think about what you talk about and all of that, is that you, without even realizing it, your parents, you're recycling their thinking. Different friends, depending on what they're going through and they're talking to you, you're recycling that. I mean, it's going through your mind, it's going through your brain. And so it's really easy to recycle the thoughts of other people as opposed to your own unique thoughts, which is one of the reasons why I'm a music person, but which is one of the reasons why I also very often when I'm in my car, different opportunities, I have nothing on and I'm just thinking. I mean, just giving yourself the gift of just thinking about what you're feeling and what's happening there. But I, you know, I spend a lot of time working on what I call my craft in terms of what I do and getting advice and hearing other, you know, other experts in areas where I'm weak to get stronger. Listen, I mean, self-doubt, I mean, that stuff really creeps in. And there's a difference in being, you know, confident and being, you know, pompous, you know, as long as you're always willing to learn, you're always willing to, you know, to engage and participate and just step back. You know, one of the things that I do is, I mean, this is an interview, so I'm talking a lot. If this thing was different, you know, you'd be hearing very little from me, and you're doing a phenomenal job because I'd be interviewing you. Well, I take the interviewing approach with everybody I meet. You know, for the most part, when I'm meeting people and they ask me about me and I'll, you know, I'll tell them, hey, I'm Kim Yancey. I'm, you know, I'm the founder, one of the co-founders of eWomen Network. And then I quickly get to, but tell me about you. You know, I really like to find out about other people. I'm just inquisitive that way. And that's the goal is, you know, I can tell you that probably most people who go to a networking event are so focused on making sure they get the news out about themselves that when they leave and you ask them, who did you meet and tell me about them, they couldn't tell you. Even if you meet them at a table, and you're doing some what I call a networking round, everybody's introducing themselves. You know, if you point to somebody and say, did you hear that introduction between her and her? What can you tell me about her? And people say, oh my God, I forgot. Well, it's because they didn't tune in. They were so busy thinking about what they were going to say, you know, what they were going to say next. So let me just summarize it by saying this. You know, there are so many unbelievable podcasts out right now. I mean, just whenever possible, use your time to elevate your knowledge, especially if you're an entrepreneur, especially if you're looking to grow your business. You know, hear those stories. The stories of failure are just as important as the stories of success. You know, I mean, you learn from both, and it gives you, you know, tremendous insight.
Definitely. You're right. There's, you know, you either win or learn, right? As I think John Maxwell's team says. Now, I'm going to take the other side, because there's an other side, right? And statistics tells us, you know, with income disparity between, you know, minorities versus non-minorities, that racism does exist in America.
Oh, yeah, it does.
And there are times that we are going to be turned down because someone else was selected, or maybe not acknowledged in the room, right? Because maybe unintentionally they flocked to someone that looked more like them. How do you deal with that when that happens, especially in a network environment, and being able to grow right outside of our own boxes, right, in our own realms? How do we tackle when racism happens and then we are the victim on the other side, or how do we deal with that?
Well, you know, it's an interesting thing, because people who are looking at me right now because of, you know, I'm light skinned and gray, you know, the gray hair. You have to think about, imagine me with the afro and maybe a goatee, you know, and in terms of my look, you know, and I'm sure I had lost jobs because I was black. You know, I'm sure that, you know, I don't know that, but I'm saying it, but I'm sure in the scheme of things, stuff like that happened. But I'm also a light-skinned black person, so I have a different experience on top of that, you know? Let me tell you, you don't want to spend any time in the things that you're passed over for. Where you want to spend time is in your positivity and your uniqueness, and bring your enthusiasm to the opportunity. I'm just telling you, it's more important that, you know, my wife has a term, and I really like this, and she calls it showtime. My wife is Hispanic. She's a Latina. And she will, go, you know, when we have to go on stage or something like that, she'll look at me and look at her, and she'll say, it's showtime. And that's our word for amp it up, bring the personality, bring the enthusiasm, bring it. And the best you can do is just to be yourself and to smile. I am just telling you, you know, you don't hear a lot of conversation about that, but smile, bring the smile to the table, bring enthusiasm, do your homework, make sure you got it, you know. But listen, this is aside from the negative, you know, stories, stuff going on with police violence, which is horrific, which is horrible, I want you to know there's a lot of positive opportunity out here too. I mean, it's a ton of it. And so it's so easy to get caught up into that negative energy, that negative vibe. And I'm not talking about, you know, put on rose colored glasses. I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying that, you know, it's showtime for you, and it's your moment, and you get to decide what comes across in that moment. You get to make it what you want it to be, and step into it. You know, your uniqueness and who you are and what you're about. And those times when you're feeling like, you know, they might think my hair is too wild, you might be thinking that, and they're thinking, what a unique hairstyle she's got. I'm just, it's just such a different time now. And I think, diversity is important to me. It's always been an important part of my life because of what it brings to the table, you know, in terms of the learning and all of that. So I'm just going to tell you, you know, most of us, and I don't know if you've heard this before, you know, you either got kind of a positive part of your personality or negative. Like you look on a positive or negative bias. You know, there's all of us are born with either a positive or negative bias. You lean one way or the other. I mean, I'm talking about it's in your DNA. And then another, you know, 20-30% of that is the environment that you live in. So you got about, you know, 20% of that you really get to control. You really get to take over the top, and you know, it makes a difference.
I love that. I love that. It's showtime, guys. It's showtime. Lean on your positive side, on your bias, and focus on the things you can change. I love that. That is incredible advice. Thank you, Kim, on that one. Now, as we wind down, and you've given us incredible insights and incredible direction of really how to propel our business forward, enter into rooms that we've never entered in before, Kim. If there was some advice that you would leave, and it can be over business, it can be personal, it can be anything, what would that advice be that you would leave to the next rising MBE?
For me, what I think is really powerful is this whole movement around mindfulness. Mindfulness. You don't have to be in a rush to respond first. You can, you know, especially with this pandemic, you know, we all have, you know, you hear about people with, you know, all of a sudden, you know, I mean, it's easy for depression to kick in. It's easy for frustration. It's all those kinds of things. But I'm going to tell you is my advice is this. You'll never be accused of being too kind. Be kind. Be kind. It's so important. I mean, Stephen Covey with his book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. I mean, this book has been out for a while. And if you've not read it, it's one of the best books of all time. The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. But there's one, you know, that whole thing of, you know, seek first to understand before being understood. In other words, you don't have to be first, okay? Make sure you understand what the other person, where they're coming from, you know, everybody has beliefs, but back it down, you know, just, you know, if you feel yourself getting anxious, you feel yourself like, you know, I'm on the verge of snapping or you want to bark at somebody or your spouse or significant other, whatever the case may be, you know, just take that breath, pull it back. I mean, bringing consciousness to your thoughts is so critical. It's so critical, you know, and because people pick up on it. You know, the thing that I've also learned is through this with Zoom and everything else that we're doing, you know, that dimension of what happens to humans when we're together, you know, there's so much vibe attached to this. I mean, you know, I know people that have talked over the phone and they had not gone out before together. They're in a dating situation. They've talked over the phone and they've not seen each other, but it was just all through a voice conversation and they really connected and bonded. And then they met in person and knew instantaneously they weren't right for each other. That human vibe, just that unspoken thing that happens. Well, it's happening all the time. All the time. I mean, there are those of you that are watching this that don't like me already. You haven't met me yet. And then there are those of you that might say, hey, he's okay. The point that I'm making, though, is that just be more self-compassionate with yourself. Don't beat yourself up. Don't tear yourself down. You know, there's enough forces out there that will do that for you for free. All you can do is do the best you can do with what you've got at the moment in that time, with the knowledge and insight that you have at that moment in that time. All right. And then don't be so quick to respond. If you have a hot trigger where all of a sudden you get upset or something, the next thing you want to back it down, just that should be the sign. I got a hot trigger. I feel like saying something angry. I feel like snapping at somebody. That's your sign to back it down. That's it. That's how you know it. Oop, I'm up. I'm backing down. These things make a huge difference, and they're going to make a huge difference in how you feel and how you approach, you know, your business and your interactions with people. And people definitely pick up on it.
Definitely that mindfulness. I mean, it can control the reaction that you are proud of or the reaction that you regret for a lifetime, right? Yeah. So definitely right. Important to be mindful before you do anything and react. So thank you. That is wonderful advice. And this has been an incredible time. Kim, you've shared so much wisdom. I mean, you are a legend. So thank you so much for doing this and really sharing, you know, your wisdom really with our audience and really with the world with that. Now, Kim, if our audience can contact you, how would they go about to contact you, to reach you, to learn more, to work with you? How would they find you?
Yeah, you know, easy. It's, first of all, it's ewomennetwork.com. So right there is all the contact information. My email is kim@ewomennetwork.com. That's Kim with a Y. kim@ewomennetwork.com.
I love that. Thank you. So Profit First Entrepreneurs, you can reach them at ewomennetwork.com or kim@enetwork.com. Thank you, Kim, so much for doing this today with us.
You got it. It's a pleasure.
Thank you.